الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا بين يدي الساعة من أطاع الله ورسوله فقد رشد واهتدى ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئًا وسيجزي الله الشاكرين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أقم الصلاة طرفي النهار وزلفا من الليل إن الحسنات يذهبن السيئات ذلك ذكرى للذاكرين صدق الله العظيم. My respected brothers and sisters, today is the 12th of Shawwal al-Mu'azzam, and this is the month which is the month before the month of Ramadan al-Mubarak. This is the time for us to spiritually, mentally, and physically prepare for the blessings of the month of Ramadan. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha says that Qala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Yasum al-Sha'ab and Yasum Sha'ban kulla, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to perform or observe the fasting of the month of Shaaban almost complete month, illa qalilan, except one or two days here and there. Because Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was spiritually and mentally already connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the fasting has got some physical toll upon the body. So he would start preparing physical, so that when the month of Ramadan comes, his body is ready to observe the fasting and then receive the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if some of us can do, and we should do, we should combine the mental, spiritual preparation with the physical preparation. But today's khutbah is about that spiritual preparation which comes through salah. Honestly, we the Muslims, we have known about salah so many times. We are reminded about it, but somehow it is not becoming the part of our life where it truly influences our inner selves, spiritually connects us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then gives us the opportunity to build upon this spiritual relationship other acts of ibadah like fasting, zakat, and the rest of the other Islamic responsibility. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, when we look into the Quran, we see that after the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most emphasized act of ibadah or act of being is iqamat salah, performing the salah to the utmost, the best of your abilities. When you look into the Quran, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about various prophets, you will see some of them, he addresses them with the direct commandment, perform salah. Some of them, he mentions them that they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has advised me to perform the salah and to establish the salah. Some of them, he portrays them as making personal du'as. Ya Allah, make me among the people who will establish salah, and make my children or progeny establish the salah. And some of them, he portrays them as ordering their families as offering or ordering them to perform the salah. For instance, look at the first encounter of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he's coming back from Madain and he sees that light, and from the bush, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly communicates with Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam The first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Musa, innani anallahu la ilaha illahu. O Musa, I am Allah, with whom there is no partner when it comes to uluhiyah. And then, wa aqimis salata bi dhikri. So accept in my tawheed and establish the salah for the sake of my remembrance, for the sake of my dhikr. So focus upon these two words, aqimis salata bi dhikri. Because salah is established to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have the personal type of relationship and personal type of discourse with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the intent of salah, even when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the prophets. And when Sayyidina Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, even in the cradle, speaks, Ibni Abdullah, Atani al-Kitab wa ja'alani nabiyya, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا لَمْ تُحَيَّ وَبَرَّ بِوَالِدَتِي وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, in his childhood, during that miraculous encounter with his nation, what does he say? I am the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he counts the rest of the commandments. وَأَوْصَانِي, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done the wasiyah to me, he has advised me to perform salah. Wa usani bi salati wa zakati ma dumtu hayya. As long as I am alive, my responsibility is to establish the salah. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises him that when he made the dua, one of his utmost dua was, Rabbi ja'alni muqim as-salati wa min dhurriyyati, Rabbana wa taqabbal dua, Rabbana ighfirli wa li walidayya wa lil mu'minina yawma yaqumu al-hisab. Oh Ya Allah, make me establish the salah. Ibrahim, Khalilullah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised him with so much, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions from his dua the most intimate dua, which is, Oh Allah, make me establish the salah. And I'll tell you why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never used the word kanu yu'adduna salah. Kanu yusalluna salah. They used to perform salah. They used to recite salah, they used to do salah. Every time, whether it is the dua or it is the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always uses the word iqamat al-salah. Waskur fil kitab Ismail, innahu kana sadiq al-wa'di wa kana rasul al-nabiyya wa kana ya'mur ahlahu bis-salah wa kana inda rabbihi marbiyya. He used to command, Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam used to command his family. Not only ask them, command his family to establish the salah. And when I am mentioning this ayah, look at how is our relationship with our children and our family, and how much commandment and advice we are giving to our children, and how many of them are truly establishing the salah. This is a big question. After mentioning all of these prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also tells us what happened after them. فخلف من بعدهم خلف أدعوا الصلاة واتبعوا الشهوات فسوف يلقون غيا. That after these prophets came their children, their coming generation. And what was the reason for their zawal? Because أدعوا الصلاة. They really wasted the salah. واتبعوا الشهوات, and they followed their desires and their dreams. فسوف يلقون غيا. So in dunya they were misled. They lost the legacy of their forefathers, the prophets, and in the day of judgment, they will be in the lowest place in Jahannam, because Ghayya is one of the lowest valley in Jahannam. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْتَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْتَرُكَ نِزْقَكَ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, command, order, ask your children, your family, this salah for observing, establishing the daily prayers. Wastabir alayha. And in that commandment, in teaching them, in asking them, in making them practice the salah, you will have difficulties. So be very patient with that. And even during the salah, you will have to be patient, because you have to take time away from your schedules, and sometimes in the cold weather and hot weather, it's not easy to find the time or to make the wudu, so you have to show the patient. La nas'aluka rizqa. We don't ask you to worry too much about your sustenance. Nahnu narzuqu. Sustenance is our responsibility. And the ulama over here, they have said that there is an ishara, and that ishara is explained in the hadith Qudsi. عَبْدِي خَلَقْتُ لَكَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَلَمْ أَعْيَ بِخَلْقِهِ. O my servant, I created for you the heavens and the earth, and it did not exhaust my power and my ability. Do you think to provide you with two times of food would exhaust my treasures? You and me, we have made a contract. You said that I am your Lord, and I accepted you as my servant. I assign you some responsibilities, like 5 times daily prayer. Now, if you do your part, I will do my part. You do your part, I will give you the rizq. But if you do not do your part, I will still give you the sustenance because I fulfill my promise. But I'll give you in such a hard fashion that you will be running like Wakshal Bariya, that like an animal, the wild animal, as much as it runs in the desert to find some water, it does not quench its thirst, it keeps on increasing its thirst. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَاسْتَغِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقَ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. The ulama, they say, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining that the people who will focus upon establishing the salah in their proper fashion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them the mus'a fir rizq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them the extension in their sustenance and will take care of their needs because this is the barakah of the salah. So my brothers and sisters, all of us, we know that we are focused so much upon earning, upon having a good life, upon establishing something which will make our life happy and full of sahada and tumanina in this life. Wallahi, if we can just fulfill our responsibilities towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and focus upon establishing the salah with proper, you know, ways and methodology, definitely it is the guarantee of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will not give us difficulties in earning and would take care of our hajah and our needs. One time, Imam Zain al-Abidin, the son of Imam Hussein bin Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he is about to say from the salah, and his face grows pale. He starts sitting and he starts crying. The people around him, they looked at him and they said, what's going on? He said, after doing whatever I have done from morning till now, I am going to go and present myself in front of Ahkamul Hakimeen, the best of all the judges, Al-Malik, Al-Qudus, the king, the one who knows my inside out. So I'm just shifting from inside that from morning till now I was myself and I forgot who I am. I forgot basically that my origin is from that nutfah, from that dirty water, and my end is that dust in the cup, and in between there is so much arrogance in me, I am, but in reality I am nothing without my Lord. This is an issue. I mean, Imam is Imam, I mean, he is the most conscious person, you know, on the face of the earth of that time, but he is trying to teach the people that sometimes we human beings have got a tendency to forget who we are and to forget who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And by means of humility in salah, by means of a sense of sheer dependence upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and faqr, it reminds us who we are, and because of the ubudiyya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we can be the crown of this creation. Now what is iqamat salah? Iqamat salah at least requires 6 elements in the salah. And I will quote some of the ayat of the Quran and the ahadith of Rasulullah sallam, and you keep on looking upon the significance of those points. Number one is, salah is started with wudu. So isbalul wudu is first element of iqamati salah. To do the wudu in its proper sense, to make sure that the faraid of wudu are complete, that sunan of wudu are complete, and we are not rushing, and I'm not going to talk about wudu too much today, but making the du'as which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made, and concluding it with the du'as which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made. As all of us, we know that when he started the wudu, he would say, Allahumma gfirli dhambi, wa wassirli fi dari, wa barikli fi rizqi. That Ya Allah, forgive my sins and mistakes. And Ya Allah, give me extension and expansion in my house. Make my house more and more wasi. It means, give me luxurious life. There's nothing wrong with that. Allahumma gfirli dhambi, wa wassirli fi dari, wa barikli fi rizqi. And Ya Allah, put the barakah in whatever sustenance you have given. And at the end, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will make dua, Allah waj'alni min al-tawwabina waj'alni min al-mutatahirin. Actually, after completing the wudu, he would say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, lahu al-mulku wa lahu al-hamd, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allah waj'alni min al-tawwabina waj'alni min al-mutatahirin. Ya Allah, make me among the purified one and make me among the forgiven one. So after that, this Ba'dul Wudu. The next thing which is important for Iqamati Salah is Ihtimam Awqati Salah. To make sure that we do the Salah on its exact proper time. And in that issue, my brothers and sisters, there are several ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When somebody asked him, Ayyu al-a'mali afdal ya Rasulullah? What is the best of the actions which is rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Prophet ﷺ said, As-salatu ala waqtiha. To perform the salah on its time. And in one of the other hadiths, when somebody asked him, Ya Rasulullah, what is the best amal, ahabbu ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most? The Prophet ﷺ said, As-salatu ala awwali waqtiha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves when the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the preference over everything else, comes to him as soon as the time of salah comes and performs or establishes the salah on the first time of salah. So first time of zuhur, first time of asr, first time of maghrib, first time of isha. This is what is ihtimam salah. And especially my brothers and sisters, the Quran has emphasized upon Salat al-Asr the most. حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى فقوموا لله قانتين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that people are going to be busy with their jobs, with their businesses. This is the middle of the day. And Salat al-Asr is going to be the time when most of the people are going to be either missing out on Salah because they are traveling, they are in the traffic, or they will not be performing it in Jama'ah, or somehow they will end up mixing up with Maghrib or Samar. Hafizu ala salawati wa salati al-husta, especially the Asr time. So ihtimam, and the ahadith of Rasulullah are very clear also, that a person who listens to the azan or knows that the time is for Zuhur or Asr, is watching a game for instance, or is sitting on the computer, or is doing something which to him is important, and then keeps on waiting until the last moment of the salah, rushes to make wudu, just perform the salah so that he can do it or she can do it on time. Rasulullah said that sometimes he gets or she gets 1/3 of the sawab of salah, 1/10 of the salah, and sometimes the salah is thrown upon his or her face as if he has not or she has not even performed it. So ihtimam awqati salah is part of iqamati salah. Ad-dawamu ala salah. If you look into the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. Quran is talking about the characteristics of the true believers. فَأَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. At the end, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. And in Surah Al-Ma'arij, هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. So dawam al-salah is part of iqamati salah, which means that not only when we are going through difficulty, then mashallah we are so much into salah, we want to do it on time. And when those difficulties are gone, then whenever I have got time, I will do it. For because my business starts early in the morning, so I will miss Fajr, but then I will join it with Asr, or I will do Maghrib because I have to open the store at such and such time. The Imam al-Salah means not forgetting the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon our time and not missing the salawat. This is part of the Qamat al-Salah. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ دَائِمُونَ. And also, the same ayah says, عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. And in one of the surah, عَلَىٰ صَلَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. حِفَاظ al-Salah. Some of the Sahaba, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hifaz al-Salah is basically to perform the fara'id with the utmost of the sense of responsibility. At the time of Qiyam, focusing upon the Qiyam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that these are the signs of the people of what? Rahman. That yubituna li rabbihim sujjadan wa qiyamah. يتفكرون في خلق السماوات يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا. When they stand up, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they are in communication with Him. When they are in ركوع وركعوا مع الراكعين وقوموا لله قانتين. So basically doing the ركوع with the proper sense of responsibility. Going to the sajda with proper sense of responsibility and learning the true essence of why we are doing. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, when a person comes in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and says Allahu Akbar and then stands in front of Him, if it is Zuhr Salah, the person reflects from morning till Zuhr and says, from morning till Zuhr, what did I do? How much of that was in line with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told me? How many mistakes did I do? How many violations did I do? And here I am standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right now. Before He makes me responsible for these mistakes on the day of judgment, let me confess them right now. Let me share with Him, yes, Ya Allah, I did make mistake. If I've done something good, let's share with Him, yes, Ya Allah, Alhamdulillah, because of Your barakah, because of Your karam, Ya Allah, I was able to do these good things. We share with Him. And if there was some kabair, a person says, Ya Allah, I ended up making this mistake. And some of the Sahaba, before they would start the Salah, they would come and they say, Ya Allah, after all of these mistakes, I have come to You, Ya Muhsin. I have come to You, O You, the Grace Giver. And You have told even to the Grace Giver, O Muhsini is Dunya, to ignore the mistakes of the people who have done wrong to you. So you are the utmost of the Muhsini. And I am the utmost of the Muzlimi, the people who have made the mistake. So I have come to you knocking at your door, hoping that you will behave with me as you have asked human beings to behave with the sinful, the transgressors. So here, all of my mistakes and sins are here. Give me from Your ihsan, forgive me from Your fadl and grace, and forgive me. And at the end of the salah, they would say, Alhamdulillah, I am coming out of it as if the mountains have been removed from me. This is the type of attitude which is called the hifaz al-salah. When you do the ruku or sajda, you find yourself in such a kind of humility and faqr, where you say, I'm not going to leave your door until you give me the bashara in my heart that yes, I am forgiven. And wallahi, my brothers and sisters, if we come with that sense of faqr, then maybe one salah is sufficient to get all of our sins forgiven. I'll come back and talk about it. The next important element is khushu fi salah. Qad aflaha al-mu'minun alladhina fi salatihim khashi'un. Now khushu is perhaps, most of the other things are external. Dawa, basically, awqat al-salah, isbab al-wudu, even hifaz al-salah, ruku, sujood, all of them are external. Now, this is the most internal part, which is khushu, that you come to the salah, and your entire body is responding to what you are reading, what you are doing, and you are feeling in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such a fashion that there's nothing in between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are directly talking to him and he is directly responding to you. And that starts as soon as you say subhanakallah. You are not saying subhanakallah. You know, somebody who is other than who you are talking to. وَبِحَمْدِكَ يُرْحَمْدِ اللَّهِ. And even when the hadith is very clear, when you start Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts responding to you, Hamadani Abdi. My servant is praising me, my servant is glorifying me. When you say Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'een, you are talking to him directly. I worship you and I seek your assistance. There's no third person, no any mediation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Direct communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Direct answers with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the khushu is in such a fashion, Ya Abhi, that you forget what is in your worldly life, in your surrounding. And I tell you, Allah, most of us, all of us, we are human beings. We have got our challenges, we have got our tensions, we have got our anxieties. We are carrying those burdens. What is the reality of khushu? That when you come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you leave everything of dunya, of business, of family, of things on the side. You go beyond the sphere of space-time, you reach in the mi'raj of a moment. As Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he went to mi'raj, he left everything of this dunya, went in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then basically shared with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all of what you have got from the pains and anxieties, and come back with the hope that this is the best I could have done, because he is the only one who can take care of what I am going through, and I do not need anybody else right now. I have shared with him and he is sufficient for me, and that is what is going to bring you this sense of lightness, this sense of tumanina, this sense of bahja and surur, and this sense of spiritual connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the sixth element of iqamat al-salah is to extend the experience of salah to the practical life. To feel the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only in your life when you are in salah or in masjid. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُتْلُ مَا أُوْحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَأَقِمِ السَّلَاةِ إِنَّ السَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ. So taking the lesson of salah and feeling the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and avoiding the haram and fahsha and munkara is what is also the element of iqamat salah. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that when the mu'minun, when they are in salah, their entire body, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتُهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. Their tawakkul is increased. Their great relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is increased. Their entire body is responding to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what is the true meaning of salah. And wallahi, my brothers and sisters, I'm going to read you one hadith, because all of us, we know the various ahadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that when a person does the salah, it takes away the mistakes and the sins, as if a person is taking shower. And the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is clear. What if somebody has got a canal or a river in front of his house and takes five times daily bath in that one? Would there be any dirt or any kind of dirt left upon him or her? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, so the Prophet said, this is the way salah cleans the person. But today I want to conclude this khutbah with one of the hadiths which is in Al-Bukhari. And many of us might have not even heard about that one. And Anas bin Malik رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كنت عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فجاءه رجل فقال يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إني أصبت حدا فأخذه علي. A person came and said, يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, I have committed something which deserves capital punishment. Please implement the haq. The haq is either chop the hand, cut the head, give 100 lashes, all of us people who do are the end of life. But I'm just one. The Prophet ﷺ did not turn his face towards it. وَحَدَرَتِ السَّلَاةِ And the time came for salah. فَصَلَّى مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The person offered the salah with رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَلَمَّا فَتَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الصَّلَاةَ قَامَ إِلَيْهِ رَجُلٌ فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنِّي أَصَبْتُ حَدَّةً فَأَقِمْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ أَقِمْ فِي أَقِمْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ After the salah, the person said, Ya Rasulullah, I have committed a capital crime. So please implement the had upon me so that I am purified. What did the Prophet say? Alayshat al-Sallay Jama'ana? Did you perform the salah with us? Kala na'am. He said, Yes, Ya Rasulullah. Kala fa'inna Allah kad ghafara laka dhanba. Or kala hadda. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven your sin or forgiven your capital punishment. Now, there is a bashara that salah can even bring the expiation for some of the hudud. Now, there's difference of opinion. Some of these ulama they say, oh, this was specific to that person because Rasulullah knew his sincerity and tawbah and made the dua, so he was forgiven. But the hudud are not forgiven until through tawbah or through punishment. But, my brothers and sisters, if a person sincerely does the salah with proper, basically, precautions and with sincerity and khushu, wallahi, it can bring the expiation for the rest of all of his or her sin. Let's work on it before the month of Ramadan comes. So spiritually, we are in tune with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our mental status, our spiritual status is ready to receive the barakat of the month of Ramadan. So that by the month of Ramadan, we are ready to receive the tajalliyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the barakat of the month of Ramadan. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin fastaghfiruh innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.